Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad. Welcome you to another edition of Muhammad and Friends, a CROE media production with you in mind. Always excited to be able to bring about a show with information that will benefit each and every one of you. This is a live interactive show. The number to call in is 773-434-6625, 773-434-6625. If you're watching us on various social media platforms, including Facebook, please like and share the broadcast. Also on our YouTube channel, CROE TV, please like, share, and subscribe each and every time that we go live. And most importantly, check out our own website, CROE.org. Just click on the CROE Media link. Enjoy the show. I have no doubt in my mind that you will enjoy the show. After you finish enjoying the show, peruse around the website. After you get caught up in all the nostalgic and the history and everything that we have on there that will benefit you, scroll on down to that donate button. And I've said it before, and I have to say it again, it is one of the best looking donate buttons I have ever seen in my life. So by all means, make a donation and keep us in mind when we talk about media and the importance of having your own outlet. We have to be careful that we don't support independent media outlets like our own. We've been doing this close to 30 years now. And if we continue, the major, so-called major media outlets, they'll interview you for 30 or 40 minutes. You tell all your friends and family, when you look at it, they give you a good 20 seconds. So support something like this that will give you a platform to get your message out. Support CROE before you need help from CROE. Speaking of that, our 36th annual Founders Day is coming up March the 12th. That's a Sunday evening from 5:30 to 7:30. It's going to be a who's who out that evening. It's our major fundraiser that we have a year. Please help us out. Tickets, we do have tickets now, but trust me when I tell you they will be going quick. So it's going to be a Sunday evening, March the 12th, 5:30 to 7:30. Our free film showing will be a Saturday, February the 4th. At 2 o'clock, it's a free film showing this month, or I should say February's film showing would be entitled, Is It Too Late? It is a broadcast that Tony Brown of Tony Brown's Journal did back in 1972 with the likes of Dorothy Height, Roy Ennis, Vernon Jordan, and including the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who phoned in and talked as well. So you wanna check that out. That would be Saturday, February the 4th at 2 p.m. And also Saturday, this coming Saturday, over at Legacy Men's Boutique, Sister Saja Wendy Muhammad of the Saja House, along with Sister over at Sean Michelle's, they will be at Legacy at 3 o'clock with a live broadcast on discussing various Muslim businesses. And Legacy Men's Boutique will be the feature business for that particular day. So with that being said, thank you for indulging me and all of that. My guest for this afternoon is our dear sister. She is running for a trustee of the village of Flossmoor. Our dear sister, Sugar Al-Amin. How are you, ma'am?
I'm great.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you for having me.
I got to ask you, because it's been on my mind. Is our parents down south? I mean, how we get sugar?
No. So my mom gave
me that sweet of a child.
Yes, gave me the nickname as a youngster, and it stuck with me. I've tried to get rid of it a few times.
Yes, ma'am.
And I couldn't, so I just owned up into it, stepped into it, and now I use it professionally.
Yes, ma'am. Now, you do have, as they say, you do have a government name.
Yes, I do.
But everybody knows you as either Clerk Al-Amin.
Yes.
Or Sugar.
Yes.
That's it, that's all.
That's it, that's all.
Well, look, give us a little background on Sugar Al-Amin.
Sure. I'm a Chicago native, born and raised. Mm-hmm. Went to the Chicago Public Schools. And then as I grew up, I migrated to, not too far, to the south suburbs, mm-hmm. right in Flossmoor, where I reside today.
Yes, ma'am.
I've been there now for 16, 17 plus years, and I've been a very busy, busy person.
Yes, ma'am.
Around that community. So, yes, that's pretty much that. And, of course, family. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a family woman.
Big family. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, you've been involved in politics for quite some time. I mean, you get it honest, because mom was definitely, you know, into politics. It's I think as a deputy registrar?
Yes, so she worked as a, she just actually worked the last polls mm-hmm. as a, what did she do? Back in the day, she actually worked at the polls and registered people to vote and worked the actual poll while they came in and voted.
Yes, ma'am. So were you with her during those times? So what got you really into it?
You know, what got me involved is me being a volunteer in and around the community. I saw her, of course, so I was always a part of that community. But growing up, I was a business owner, a young business owner in the city. I owned hair salons. And that is what I think got me involved, because being a business owner, such as myself, I wanted to help the community. So I would connect with the Business of Commerce, and when they had the back-to-school parades and things like that, I wanted to know how could I help our community outside of being a business owner.
Yes, ma'am.
So that is what directly got me connected into the political scene. Not being in it, but outside of it. So,
What's some of the things that you learned as a small business owner?
First thing I learned was it has to be a passion because you're never off. Even when business shut down, you were still working. You had to be dependable and give good services. With that, I owned hair salons. And
salons, not plural.
Yes, yeah. So I own two. Serenity Springs, I'm quite sure a few people know if they are watching. What I learned was when you're in your community, you have to be proud. So when people come in and you're giving service, or if I'm the boss, I have to make sure that the people that were renting booths for me and I had to make sure that I always set an example to just give quality service and to make sure that anybody that came in and patronized our business, that you that we honored every dollar.
Yes, ma'am.
Every dollar.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
Made sure we spent it in the community too.
Yes, ma'am.
That was something important.
And so that understanding, that rationale, you took it with you into I guess what we call the political field.
And so sure did.
And so how did you apply that type of information?
I think when I moved out to Flossmoor, in a great community. I mean, the community that everything is there. So you had community, you had businesses, you have the good schools. When I got there, I realized that I wanted to make sure I patronized our businesses. I wanted to make sure that I wanted to know what was happening with our school systems. That's how it helped me, because you can be a part, but when you don't, when you're not volunteering and being actually physically a part, then that's the game changer.
Yes, ma'am.
So that is what I took with me from being a young business owner, because I was 26 having a hair salon, you know, and most people that rented booths for me, they were older than me.
Yes, ma'am.
So I had to learn how to delegate, and I had to learn how to listen to people's concerns and make sure I got them done. So that's another thing that I took with me.
And you know, one other thing that came to mind as you were saying, as a 26-year-old, you said you had older women that rent booths from you. I guess in that same political field, as I came in as a young person, you have older people that may have said, well, I've been here.
Freshman politician.
So how do they relate?
That has been interesting.
Yeah.
It's an everyday constant, you're constantly on with letting people know how real you are or how serious you are about serving.
Yes, ma'am.
But what I think sets me different amongst the rest is I'm into serving people. So I'm not really big on the political side of it. I focus on why I'm there. What service am I providing for my residents? So when I'm around other politicians, very seasoned politicians, I'm sure they're about their agendas. But what I like to do is make sure that when I encounter them, I'm talking about what it is I'm doing for my community.
Yes, ma'am.
And I think that's how I've kind of gained some, you know.
Some respect.
Yeah, some respect, ma'am. in the game.
But let's go back, because you said you were involved in your community prior to becoming any type of elected official.
Yes.
Why not just stay, you know, it's a lot of people that's involved. They do certain things. You always see them out. Why step into that game of politics?
Okay, so it is most definitely not for everybody. But I was a part for years and still serving as the Flossmoor Service League member. And what we do is a bunch of ladies who we gather, we get charities. We raise money for our charities year round, and we help people that are in need inside our community and around. So that put me in different settings where I wanted to do more. Then I also volunteer on the Community Relations Commission Board, where I'm dealing directly with the residents, directly with law enforcement, talking about concerns and what we can do to better our community, what we don't want to change about our community. What made me want to make that transition is having some power behind my action. When you volunteer, that's one thing, but when you make it political, you have power to make those changes to champion for your community after you heard the concerns.
Yes, ma'am. And so what was that first office that you decided to run for?
Rich Township Clerk. And that is the office that I'm happily serving in right now. I'm going into my second year in April. I love this position because it has gotten me outside of Flossmoor. I serve 10 municipalities. So I'm serving Flossmoor and nine other villages that surround Flossmoor.
So, and what are your duties as clerk?
So as clerk, the first thing about clerks is we are keeper of the records. So with the township, all of the things that are done, all of the services that are provided, the clerk's department is that record keeper. You can go back 100 years and you're going to see that my office has kept those archives. So that's the first thing. The second thing is we act as a liaison with other parts of the township in what they're doing and what we're, what they're trying to do, like with the pantry, with the senior department. And of course, I serve under our great supervisor, Calvin Jordan, where he has, in 2 years, when I tell you we have been busy, I don't know if you've heard, but we were announced the Township of the Year.
Yeah, Mr. Jordan, he's been well trained under the great John H. Stroger.
Oh, yes. And, yes. I've heard lots of stories.
Yeah, Mr. Jordan, he has assembled a team out there like no other.
I mean, he is a man behind action.
Yes.
He has laid out a clear vision, and we have executed it step by step.
Yeah.
And I've been happy to be a part of that team.
But talk about that, about in the South Suburbs in particular, because a lot of times it's more associated with people that look like you and I, black people. And so normally in Illinois, Chicago is the center of all politics. But it seems like of late, the South Suburbs has really been become recognized as a political force out there. You know, you even got Chicago politicians looking for help and willing to kiss the ring of the people that's out there. So talk about that transition, you know, like that's like that, like almost like that shift of power and influence out in the South Suburbs, and how you feel being a part of that.
I think it's our time right now. We have a bunch of politicians that are fired up about bringing back the life to the Southland. We want all to be touched. You know, like I said, I live in Flossmoor and we have a great community, but we want each and every community in the Southland to have all the opportunities. And I think the people that are in place at this time, it's just everything is aligned and we are working together. And as you know, when you work together, that's when you get things done. So it's a clear message. We all have a clear task, and literally, that's what we've been working on with the mayors. We have our president of Cook County, Tony Pretwinkle, who comes to all of our events, and she's played a big, big, major part in helping us get funding for different things that we're trying to move forward in the Southland.
Yes, ma'am.
So it's just sometimes, you know, you actually get it right. And I think right now with the people that we have in power in the Southland, you've seen a lot these last 2 years. But there is much, much more to come because we are dedicated and we have a clear vision for the people in the Southland.
Yes, ma'am. Do you all meet often?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Because the reason why I ask, because I was looking at something with like some of the CEOs, you know, Amazon and, you know, Apple and all of these, and they get together to talk about some of the issues of, imagine them having issues that they have. So I was just curious about, you know, with all those personalities out there, do you meet often? How often do you meet, and how smoothly does do the meetings go?
So you know what? Even with my mayor, of course, we all know Amazon has played a big part in building and bringing a lot of jobs out to the Southland. And I've been a part of some meetings where we've met with mayors and different community leaders where they are active. So once they bring the business out there, get the jobs, they're still a part of the planning. Mm-hmm. So that's what's happening now. Every assignment that we have, we're meeting regularly. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of different organizations, too, that I am a part of out in the Southland, like the Democratic Women of the Southland Region, Rich Township Democratic Organization. So these are different entities that I'm involved in. And mm-hmm. again, with our Rich Township Democratic Organization, Calvin Jordan, he is actually the committeeman and over mm-hmm. that as yes, well, ma'am. Him and Yumiko Brown. Mm-hmm. But with everybody meeting regularly, it keeps the conversation going, mm-hmm. which keeps us on target to stay on the backs of the people that we need to get resolution from mm-hmm. and we need to get action and money from. So yes, I think that's what has happened.
Nice, mm-hmm. nice. Mm-hmm. And so with all that, because obviously you've gained plenty of experience. You have a lot of mentors that are you able to seek counsel with.
Yes, tap and, into.
Yes, yes. So it seemed, you came to the point now that you did all you could mm-hmm. now in this present position. It's time to take it up a notch.
I'm glad you
so
said
So you decided
that.
To run. You're running now. Your petitions are filed. You're on the ballot for candidate for trustee
yes.
of the Village of Flossmoor.
I am second on the ballot. Okay. I am a proud candidate.
Yes, ma'am.
Hitting the ground running. Yes. So mentioning what you just said, mm-hmm. with all of this experience that I've had just in the last 2 years of serving as clerk and touching so many different legislatures, mm-hmm. it would be a no-brainer. Mm-hmm. It would be crazy if I did not step into to run for this position as trustee.
Yes, ma'am.
With the relationships that I've made, with all of the volunteerism that I've done, mm-hmm. and with the residents and with the legislatures, it's like a happy marriage. Mm-hmm. So with me running, with my decision to run for trustee of Flossmoor, I think that was the best thing for me at this time, so that I can continue on with, you know, the conversations and keeping Flossmoor a part of that outside conversation as the Southland grow, and to help Flossmoor continue to move in the upper position that we have been moving in. I mean, come on, Flossmoor is like an awesome,
yes, ma'am.
A awesome village, fiscally responsible, great families, number one school district.
Yeah.
So it's a great place to want to be at the table to help make decisions going forward.
I will say this before we continue on. It's one thing about it. Y'all serious about those school boards out there in the South Suburbs. I've been to a couple of meetings, and they can get rowdy. I mean, they are serious about it.
So I do want to say, and I'm not being biased, but for Flossmoor School District, we're kind of calm,
okay.
mannered, because these people have been working together so long. But I will say, in the Southland, we've had some, you know, combustion. but,
okay.
you know, you have a lot of people that are so committed mm. to making sure that all the schools out there get all the same opportunities.
Yeah.
Flossmoor, I mean, we were a blue ribbon school. You
yeah.
know, we come from eons of just a good
yes,
school
ma'am.
District. We just have what it takes. But I will say that overall, we've had some things.
Now, don't get me wrong. I admire the fact that the people willing, because a lot of times they don't even go to meetings.
Mm-hmm.
But I've been to meetings, they were full,
mm-hmm.
and they're really active. I mean, even when people run for the school boards out there, they are serious about it. So, you know, that just kills a myth that our people are not interested in the education of our children. And that's the farthest thing from the truth.
But I want to remind you, like you said, the demographics is mostly us out there.
Yes, ma'am.
And saying that, it's many myths that we have to live out of within every day.
Mm-hmm.
We are committed
yeah.
in whatever communities we work in.
Mm-hmm.
So the myth of us not being, you know, forward and upfront for our communities and for our children,
mm-hmm.
that is crazy. In Flossmoor, and I have to stick with Flossmoor because
yes, ma'am.
I need the viewers to know that I am ready to get this seat and just move forward with all the great knowledge and experience that I have. In Flossmoor, we have what we need, but we need to make sure as we continue to move forward that we continue to put the right people in place to sustain that and to move forward when new opportunities come.
Yes, ma'am.
And I have to be a voice at the table when those new opportunities come, because for certain legislators, I can call them right up and say, okay, now y'all think we got everything we need over here, but we want some more. Because our kids, I mean, they deserve what they have and more. And that's for all Southland. But in Flossmoor, I don't want anybody to think that, oh, everything's great, because it is. But there is more to come, and we want a piece of that pie, too.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I can hear the passion in your voice. So, but talk about, for those of us that may not know, now, a trustee, is that equivalent to an alderman in
Absolutely.
Chicago? So talk about what a trustee is and the role of a trustee out
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely. So a trustee serves at the right and the left of our mayor.
Okay.
And we are a board that work together to make decisions and votes for the infrastructure, water, our finance, our school boards, law enforcement. So we tap in at every level. And we are even green, growing grass, all of that. We are the group that make things work. And if something is not working, we might have to put something on the table to, you know, take it away.
Yes, ma'am.
But also, trustees can bring forward new initiatives as well that they might have knowledge of. And that's what I plan on doing. Some things that, you know, they might not know about. And I can bring forth, I would have that power to bring different initiatives together. And with me being wanting to be a trustee, I plan to keep tight with the Community Relations Commission that I'm already a part of, because
ma'am,
I already have a open conversation with our residents.
Okay.
And I plan on navigating over to law enforcement as well.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. To work with them.
Yes, and that's definitely needed.
It is. And it is. I've already did a little work with them too.
And it's funny, it's not funny, but it's since you brought that up.
Absolutely.
Because you do have a background in mental health. And I definitely want to talk about that.
Okay.
I'm a big proponent of mental health. And you mentioned the police. And, of course, you know, we have several issues that's going on now, and in particular the one that's going on in Memphis. But a lot of times, as we already know, when it's the police are called out and it's a mental health issue, a lot of times there's been issues out there in the south suburbs with people losing their lives, and they could have still been alive. So talk about, you know, even, you know, why you went into the mental health as one of your areas anyway, and how that would apply into what you're doing now.
Okay.
And what you seek to do also.
Sure. So I did some community service, and I worked with a facility called the Jones Community Center, where we worked with children after school. And that's where I got some of my mental health training from.
Okay.
We had to take a lot of mental health courses because, as you know, when you have kids in underprivileged neighborhoods, you know, they deal with a lot. Those children grow up much faster than a kid who has everything that they need. And we had to take different classes to prepare us to be able to recognize certain things that children might be going through, a certain, you know, certain things that they would show us that, okay, we need to deal with that. So that is where I got a lot of my mental health certifications from. But moving forward to the Community Relations Commission, I took on a project to ride along with our law enforcement. And I did a ride along with our officer, and I was able to have that conversation with the officer as he, you know, we did his shift. And I think the biggest thing that I would like to touch on when it comes down to mental health and dealing with our law enforcement, in addition to all of their training, we talk about having other professionals who are trained in that, with social work and mental health treatment. I think that it would be a great idea if we added more mental health certifications for the officers, because they deal with a lot every day.
Oh, yeah.
And of course, you know, we deal with the demographics of black and white and how we're viewed. So in addition to keeping the conversations going with them to help them understand how you look at the color black and white, because that's an issue. It is a big issue.
Yeah.
We need more mental health certifications and training.
Yes,
so that they can, if they go on a call, and they can recognize that it might be a mental health call versus a criminal call. And so what is to be done? Now, they have a lot of that training already, but I just think that that's something going forward that all of America needs to work on.
Yeah, yeah, that's an excellent point, and you brought up something that that's just as important also, someone to talk to the officers as well, because mm-hmm. there was a lot of suicides that was happening in
Absolutely.
Chicago and the south suburbs, or the suburbs in particular, in yes. general, I should say, haven't really been talking about. I'm pretty sure they do. They go through just as many. Everyone
oh, my
wants
goodness.
To get home at night,
yes.
and then, you know, they have to find some type of outlet. So
mm-hmm.
that's important. That's something that I didn't even think about. I guess I was so concerned with the residents. We got to think about. There are some.
Yeah, because you want a mentally stable
yeah.
person that is, you know, going protecting our community.
Yes.
And you have to. And like I said, they have a lot of things in place, but that is something that. When you want to champion your community with good law enforcement, because law enforcement is not all about fighting crime. It's mm-hmm. about working together with the law enforcement to keep crime down and to for them to be okay to like go into the communities and actually have relationships with the community.
Nice.
And in Flossmoor, we do have that, but as you know, we all fall short, and America has fallen short on that, of course, with our, you know, situation, like you just said, with mm-hmm. the killing in Tennessee. Tennessee.
Memphis,
Memphis, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
But it's just important that I can be a voice where I can continue to take the messages and the concerns from the residents to our law enforcement, because I want us to work hand in hand. Mm-hmm. I don't want it to be like that.
Excellent. What's the response been like out there? Because this is like another level, you know, and so what's the response been like out there with the residents? You know, how they've been receiving you as far as, because you look like, you sound like you got on the ballot pretty easy. Maybe I'm just looking at it from the as an outsider.
Yeah.
But I guess it was. How many petitions do you need?
Okay, so I only needed 128 signatures.
Mm-hmm.
I got a total of 474 signatures.
Okay.
I was really well received, and I humbly. Say that. I've been in this community for a long time, and mm-hmm. even with gathering my petitions, it was much easier than what I thought it would be.
Mm-hmm.
But I've been well received in all parts of my community, with the business, with the village, with our residents, and even people that work closely with Flossmoor who are not actual voting residents.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm very, very grateful for that.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm excited about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
What I want to do, are we able to take a break? I want to take a break.
Okay.
So we can catch our breath.
Yes.
I want to encourage the people to call in. The number is 773-434-6625. I'm pretty sure we got plenty of South Suburban viewers. So you got a question, you know, she's not going to be here forever. So make sure you call in and have a question for our dear sister. So what we want to do, we want to take a break and come on back and continue our conversation with our dear sister, Sugar Al-Amin, candidate for trustee for the village of Flossmoor. We'll be back. And we are back to Muhammad and Friends. The number to call in to speak to our dear sister, Sugar Al-Amin, 773-434-6625, 773-434-6625. Really enjoying the conversation with you this afternoon, my dear sister. And you're fired up. You're really excited about it. And, fresh voices are needed.
Yes.
You know, in Chicago, the city council, it's a lot of people stepping down. And, you know, I know it's a difference, but I still have to ask you. I mean, because you're astute. You keep up with what's going on.
I do.
People are like, you know, that's it. I'm not going back. So, but you, instead of running away,
you're running into it
yeah. even deeper. Because, yes. I mean, you know, a trustee, you know, it's like you said, it's equivalent to an alderman.
Yes.
So that means... You're not going to be able to go into the grocery store without getting questioned about something. You're going to be out to dinner with your family. They're going to be coming up to you. So you're serious about this, huh?
You know, serious is an understatement. Mm. I am every day going to sleep thinking about it, and I wake up thinking about becoming the trustee of Flossmoor. And as I've been moving around the Southland talking to other trustees, they remind me of some things. You know, they've been wanting to give their input, and that's another thing. I've been totally supported by trustees from that live in Flossmoor mm-hmm. and other municipalities around Flossmoor. One thing I could say is some of them have told me, okay, they have our cell number and they could call you in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Hey, a deer is in the backyard. What can we do? You know, well, call 911
yeah.
but I'm ready for that.
Yeah.
Because I've kind of been doing that.
Mm.
And so it won't be anything new.
Mm-hmm.
The newness of it will be, I will actually be able to do some things about it.
Yeah.
Not just, oh, okay, that's your concern. Okay, I'll take it back. And
so
now when things are asked of me, I actually can have some weight in the game
mm-hmm.
and, you know, and help with that.
What's the breakdown of Flossmoor, like, you know,
yes.
Age-wise,
oh, yeah.
you know,
mm-hmm. The demographics?
Yes, and, yes.
Okay, so we have about a little under 60% Black, non-Hispanic,
mm-hmm.
and 38%, a little under 40% White.
Mm-hmm.
Others, and the rest others, which is Asian, mm-hmm. Hispanic, we got it all.
Yes, ma'am.
That's one of the reasons why I'm excited about becoming a trustee, because the community that I live in is a very diverse community.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if I could, I would like to give some reasons to the viewers
yes,
of why people move to Flossmoor and have lived there forever.
Because it's a beautiful, quaint little village.
It really is.
So,
it really is.
Yeah.
I mean, we, 26 minutes from the city.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great access to Chicago. We have the top schools.
Mm-hmm.
Our community is so blended, and we get along well with each other.
Mm-hmm.
We also have beautiful properties
mm-hmm.
where people take pride in their property.
Yeah,
and that's something I really love.
Yes, ma'am.
Also, even with our law enforcement and all of our public leaders, everybody seems to get along, even when sometimes things get hard.
Mm.
But these are reasons. It's like a little hidden gem.
Mm.
We have, speaking of the hidden gem,
mm-hmm.
Once a year in September, we have something called the Hidden Gem Marathon,
okay.
where people from all over the world come and run in our marathon. And then we end it off with the Flossmoor Fest, where we represent all businesses and all volunteer circles. They come in and we party all night.
Wow.
I mean, it's a great community to visit. It's a great community to live in, and it's a great community to serve in.
Yes, ma'am. Excellent, excellent. Looks like we do have a caller.
Okay.
So, you mind taking a caller, too?
Hey, I'm all in.
Yes, ma'am. Let's go. So, caller, you on the air with Sugar Al-Amin.
As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum salam.
And good afternoon to your distinguished guest.
Good
afternoon. Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. I would like to know, what is actually a trustee? I've been hearing it so many years, and I want to know, is that like an alderman, or is that like a mayor, or whatnot? And secondly, why did so many people move out from Chicago out to that area? Was it the schools or the hospitals or something like that?
Okay.
And lastly, your wonderful name, Al-Amin, is that Did you get that name from somebody we know in Chicago that's prominent? Because I knew of one guy ran the city colleges over here. Kennedy King once was Brother Al-Amin. So I'll hang up and listen. So thank you for coming on the show. And you look fabulous on TV with my brother Mandene there.
Thank you, sir. Your check's in the mail.
Thank you so much for calling in with those questions. I'll start with the first. And you asked about what is a trustee. And a trustee is what you stated. It is serving as like an alderman to the mayor. So I'll be in service with the mayor as we have the rights where we are in charge of building our community together. So it's sitting on the board with the mayor, serving, like you said, as an alderman, but it's called trustee. The second question is, you asked about why people moved out to the Southland and to Flossmoor in particularly. And you also answered your question, which is we have great schools. So that is one of the main reasons why people move out to Flossmoor. And it is because of our schools and the safety. And it's just a beautiful community. If you haven't been, I would suggest you come out there and visit. We have great restaurants, but it's a nice community even to drive through and to look at our great properties. And last but not least, my husband, Rafi Al-Amin, his dad, Khalid Al-Amin, senior, Khalid Al-Amin, senior, who was a part of the Nation of Islam here in our city. My father-in-law, who is deceased, but that is where I get my name from. So yes, you might know of the Al-Amins here in Chicago, but that is where I get my last name from. And thank you so much for asking.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it was referring to Clyde Al-Amin.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Is it related?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
But hey, it's a small world.
Oh, it is. It is. It is.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So I am related to the Al-Amin family, and Khalid Al-Amin and Patricia Al-Amin, who was is Patricia, still part of the Nation of Islam.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Another thing, because like I said, I just had to bear witness to you, because you never hear anything about Floss. Only thing you hear about Flossmoor is how beautiful the homes are, how nice it is. You know, as you said, you're boasting about the different restaurants. It really is that quaint little area that attracts people. Mm-hmm. So I can see the enthusiasm, you know. So what was that your first, when you, because like I said, we established that you are a Chicagoan. Mm-hmm. You're still a Chicago girl at heart. Mm-hmm. But you decided to go on out there. Was that the first time that you thought of going to? Or?
So I lived previously in Richland Park. Mm-hmm. And then when I married Rafi Al-Amin, that's where we both decided to live, in Flossmoor.
Yes, ma'am.
Which we made a great choice. Mm-hmm. And speaking on that, when you were saying about the restaurants and stuff, I want to double back. Mm-hmm. We do have a lot of great little boutiques and restaurants and things like that. But as a future trustee, I'm hoping that we can get some attention of some larger five-star restaurants and bring it out there. Because what I'm learning about our Southland is we have resources, and we want those bigger companies to come out there and to shop with us and be with us so that we can have those things at our fingertips where we don't have to go to other communities, you know, far away to go and eat or do something nice. So we have some nice restaurants and things like that.
Because it's very important to be able to stay in your own area.
Yeah, you want to spend money where you live.
Right. You know,
eat where
whether
you
it's
live.
A grocery store, restaurant,
yeah,
it's
shop
very
where
important.
You live.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. So that's something that definitely I see you're advocating for.
Yes.
Let's go back again to the campaign trail.
Yes.
And let's talk about, because you can't do this by yourself. You're not a one woman band, so you have to have support. I mean, talk about the support that you have presently, you know, and how's it like going out there with people that you can depend on?
Thank you for asking that. So when I ran for Rich Township clerk, my family jumped right on board, and I had a great, like my daughter and my son-in-law who run Legacy Strategies, Michael Harris Jr. and Jarnay Harris, they were pretty much, we were the team.
Yes,
and my family, first of all, let me go back. I would not have even committed if my husband and my immediate family did not say they were on board. Mm-hmm. So that was the first thing.
Yeah.
And so just having that, you know, that that's your foundation. And I've found very, very quickly in the political world, you have to have that core.
And you know what, hold that thought, but let's talk about that, because that's something you just can't graze over.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because when you have a husband and you out here in this political mm-hmm. field, and if it's a, and it's a woman, most men, you know, they want to protect their woman.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you out there, you know, you can hear some things. You know, people are losing it. They don't have no filters nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
They feel like they can just say anything to you, not only online, but in person and everything. Like mm-hmm. I said, you know, people, once you get in these positions, they feel like you don't have any more privacy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you belong to them. That could be good and bad. And so, you know, that's something that really has to be talked about. You know, a man has to be comfortable in his own skin because his wife
mm-hmm.
is out there in the forefront now. So I think that's something that needs to be pointed out.
Of course, it's like your foundation.
Mm.
And my husband, I am the proud wife of Rafi Al-Amin, where he and his brothers have a company in the Southland in Crete, mm. Al-Amin Brothers Transportation,
mm.
20 plus years.
Yes, ma'am.
And with that, with leadership, comes comfortability and trust mm. and security.
Yes, ma'am.
And with my husband and his brothers running the company that they run, it's a lot that they do and a lot that they're responsible for.
Mm.
So what I found with my husband, with him being in a strong leadership position, he gets it.
Mm.
And that's something that we have in common.
Yes, ma'am.
So he's not worried about, he knows that I'm living in my truth
mm-hmm.
and he knows that when people are able to live in their truth every day and serve and in service, then you know that you should support. And that's how we both are.
Yes,
so that is something that I have that is solid and I'm very, very, very thankful for, because actually I bump all type of ideas off of him, because running a successful company is not easy.
Yes, ma'am.
And with that, with all that experience, that has also helped, you know, with me. And I've had past businesses as well. So
mm-hmm.
that's something that we share, and that's something that we are, that we support each other in. And with the naysayers, as you talked about, people saying things, I mean, that comes with the territory.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you take on leadership positions, you open yourself up to the public, and we don't know what they're going to say.
Yes, ma'am.
But when you stay, when you keep your eye on the prize and you stay focused on what you're trying to do, especially in service, I want to reiterate that word.
Mm.
Service is what I am about.
Yes, ma'am.
That is first and foremost. So when I'm focused on that, then I'm okay with everything else.
Mm.
I'm not worried about the, you know, the ear
yeah.
ear chatter, the chatter on the side.
Keep it on the
yes,
side.
Yes, yes. And
yeah.
and my family, like I said, I just have such a great a devoted family who has just said, okay, we see this vision and we're right there with you.
Yes, ma'am.
So that is something that I am truly grateful for.
Yeah.
Yes.
Excellent, excellent. So are you looking for volunteers?
Yes.
So
glad
not only
you
that,
asked.
Because we want to get this in a couple of
yes,
times.
Yes, yes.
You know, if you have a punch number,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
also, you
thank
know,
you.
Maybe somebody out there that may not necessarily want to get out there and hit the streets with you, but they may want to make a donation.
Thank you.
Some
glad
money
you asked.
You. That's your camera right
all
there.
All right, all
and,
right.
Hey, ask.
So, again, info@friendsofsugar.com. We are taking donations. We are asking for volunteers. We are asking for you to make phone calls to your friends who live in Flossmoor. They might not know about me. If you know about me, then tell a person about me. Also, we will be canvassing Flossmoor area every Saturday from 11 to 1. We will send out a bulletin on social media and all other types of avenues where we can get it out there, and we'll tell you where we'll be. Just show up. We want to hit the ground running every Saturday at 11.
Mm.
We have 8 neighborhoods to serve in Flossmoor, and I want us to hit them all, because I understand that you can, you know, show pictures and things like that, but I want to be in the community. I want to knock on some doors and meet some people. I already know a lot, but I want to meet some more, and I want you all to get to know me, so that when you go to the ballots, early voting is March, I want to say March 6th, and I might be a little off on that, but April 4th is Election Day. Mm-hmm. That's the most important thing, and I'm second on the ballot.
Yes, ma'am.
Arlene Sugar Al-Amin, second on the ballot for Trustee of Flossmoor, and come out and vote because I want to represent you. I want to serve you in Flossmoor, our residents.
You have a punch number?
So no punch number. It's 1-2.
Okay.
So I think it's like 1-2-3-4, and I'm second on the ballot.
Yes, ma'am.
But
just
yes.
Make sure they can count. Yes. And spell. So sugar.
Well, sugar is easy to remember. So I kind of, you know, it's going to be on there. So you should be able to see that. But I am second on the ballot. So.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
You know, I was at Larry Rogers Sr.
Oh, yeah.
His
yes.
funeral was
yes.
yesterday. And again, my condolences to the family.
Yes. Yeah.
Of Larry Rogers Sr. But his grandchildren and great-grandchildren, they were there. And of course, there was one, and I feel bad, but I think this is the first grandson
mm-hmm.
that graduated law school
oh, wow.
and became a lawyer. He okay. spoke on behalf of the grandchildren and the grandchildren. He stood tall like a soldier, but I was just looking at the legacy and the continuation of the foundation that Larry Rogers Sr. had had laid, and this we didn't even get to Larry Rogers Jr. yet, and so but to see all of those young people, and not only that young man, but at least eight others in the family mm-hmm. went on to become lawyers, and then not even to talk about the countless people in attendance who was influenced by Larry Rogers Sr.
Mm-hmm.
who went on to become judges and lawyers and so on and so forth, and the people that he has helped. So I say all that to say I've seen a lot of political organizations,
mm-hmm.
you know, come and go. They were strong at one time, but they didn't, you know, it wasn't a clean handoff of the baton. You know, it wasn't a smooth transition.
Mm-hmm.
Or if it was trying to be a good handoff, the young people didn't, you know, they didn't appreciate
mm-hmm.
it. They
mm-hmm.
didn't they didn't take the work on to, you know, to further it. So I say, and I see you're picking up what I'm putting down.
So, yes, yeah,
hey,
I'm look, ready.
So what I'm asking you is, of course, you know, you're doing this work. You've been doing it for a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, who are you mentoring? You know, because obviously people, great ones are mentoring you. You got the likes of Calvin Jordan and Debbie Myers Martin.
Yes.
And Justice Lyle.
Yes.
Just to name a few.
Yes.
So, you know, but who's coming? Who's the next sugar?
Mm-hmm,
you know, because
mm-hmm.
this seems just natural, this easy breezy for you. But, you know, we all got to move on. So who's next up?
So what I hear you saying is a succession plan.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't have that. For those of us who lead, we should live in our succession plan every
mm-hmm.
day.
Mm-hmm.
You lead by example. You pull from the people that are near you.
Yes, ma'am.
And right now, the next sugar is still me.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
So I'm in it. I'm living in it.
Yes, ma'am.
But as I stated earlier, my son and daughter
mm-hmm.
who run Legacy Strategies, they are my campaign managers.
Teach.
Okay. So they're with me wherever I go. That's already a succession.
Mm-hmm.
I have one grandchild, Miss McKenzie.
Yes, ma'am.
She's 1.5, but when I tell you this 1.5-year-old has been to more political events than I've been to.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, again, you don't go anywhere by yourself.
Mm.
To me, when you're in leadership, with whatever you're doing, you have to make sure you're whatever flock that is with you
mm-hmm.
should be with you.
Mm.
It's not about, oh, it's all me and I'm doing this. No. Everybody in my family has a job. And
mm-hmm.
Outside of their day-to-day jobs with what I'm doing in public service,
mm.
they have a direct job, something that they want to do.
Mm.
And I could only hope that me and my husband's legacy of having very, very, very successful businesses and being successful now in public service could only leave all of our kids and our great-grandkids and from eons to come, many generations, with them having that in their bosom to
mm-hmm.
want to get up every day and to serve.
Yes, ma'am.
Or to work and lead. Because I will tell you, in my family, we do have a lot of strong leadership.
Mm-hmm.
leadership. Just it's natural. It's natural. So yeah. And it's important, like I said, that we just focus on succession plans.
Absolutely. Yes. No, I hear you, and I'm it's serious because the only way to escape death is not to be born. Not that we're trying to. You're still a young
live,
woman.
You got
a
lot of. Die.
But the thing about it is just to lay those that foundation. Mm-hmm. You know, you just, I think about different businesses here that just, you know.
They dwindle.
They're gone.
Yes, yeah.
And then when you think of like a established business like Leek & Sons Funeral Home.
Oh, yes.
And,
you
know, third and fourth generations now.
Absolutely.
You know, moving on. So
you have to be definite.
Yes, ma'am.
You have to be definite about what your vision is for your family, even if they don't go into exactly what it is you're doing, you still want to bring them along with what you're doing because you don't know how they can tap into that, even with their own personal choices and their career plans. Mm-hmm. So it's just vital. And I think a lot of our communities, we should work, be a little bit more diligent about that. You got people that get up and go to work every day. But what is it that, what work ethic are you spilling down to teaching to your children and to their children? And it's important. So
Absolutely.
I do it every day.
Yes, ma'am.
Because little Mackenzie, she going to be right with me. You know, in the trustee's office when I'm making them votes.
Yes, ma'am. and that's important. I mean, even though she's one and a half, but you see it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you see it not only in the political field, but you see when people, white folks, they come and they bring their children to fix your door.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have their child with them also. They're learning. Mm-hmm. You know, they're raising them on up. So I take my hat off to you for the work that you're doing with your family, extending that legacy on. But again, we want to remind the people as we begin to close out. We got about 4 minutes, so we want to really run it home about how important this election is, and how important it is to have a voice out there that will advocate for the people in the village of Flossmoor.
First, I want to leave our viewers with this. I want everybody out there watching to know that you can do whatever you set your mind to. That's the first thing I want to leave. I have been a public servant long before I decided to actually be a public servant. It was in me from the beginning. And I know that with all of my work, all of my travels, that right now, with me making this choice to be the next trustee of Flossmoor, that is the right choice. Not so much for myself, but more so for the residents of Flossmoor. Those are the people that are going to benefit from me winning this position. So, again, I want our viewers to know that on April 4th, get up and go and vote Arlene Sugar Al-Amin, second on the ballot, so that I can get to work for all of my residents who I love, and I'm already serving y'all, so I'm ready to move it up to the next level and serve you guys as Trustee Al-Amin after April 4th.
Yes, ma'am. We got a couple of minutes. But you feel you're ready day one.
Yes. Day one.
No,
I
have to walk
now.
You around, show you where everything is at. You ready to come in and just change offices.
I'm at the village all the time.
Yes, ma'am.
Talking to the mayor, the manager, the fire department, they all know me by Sugar.
Yes, ma'am.
So it is like a home away from home.
Yeah.
So once I win and I'm able to show up on day one, I'm just ready to move it to the next level.
Talk about the importance of collaborating because obviously when you said as a role of clerk, you have to deal with the different the other municipalities also. So talk about the importance
inclusion.
Of establishing inclusion, building relationships, and how, that will benefit the people of Flossmoor.
So, when you said that, like I said, what I thought about was inclusiveness. We have many opportunities that pass us, but when you're able to have someone like me who's already out there working with other legislators, working with other municipalities, I already have some common knowledge on what is happening, what's going on. And you know, with maintaining what we have in Flossmoor and building on that is something that I can help with because I do believe in inclusion. You know, you get some people, oh, I know about it, we're going to keep it here. No, you have to spread the word. I think that everybody should have the opportunity for growth in their community. And again, even with a beautiful community like Flossmoor, there are still different opportunities that we can win from. And that is what I know that I can bring to the table, serving as clerk of Rich Township now.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm ready to bring some ideas.
Yes, ma'am.
Let's get the voting happening.
Yes, ma'am. Tell them again. Let them know what they need to do.
Let's get to it. Again, call your friends, your family, people that live in the city. I know y'all got friends in Flossmoor and in the Southland. Like I said, let them know that Sugar Al-Amin is ready to win this race for trustee of Flossmoor so that I can get in and help and to continue what we've already sustained there, but build on that.
Yes,
so,
ma'am.
I'm ready.
And you're number two.
I'm number two on the ballot.
And if people want to still time to volunteer, they want to volunteer, they want to make a donation, that information
yes.
again?
Yes. So I have a Facebook page, which is Arlene Sugar Al-Amin. You can go on my Facebook page. We have information there. We'll be posting weekly all kinds of information about our campaign. Friend Arlene Sugar Al-Amin. To donate, info@friendsofsugar.org. But again, if you go on Facebook, you can find ways to donate as well. I'm just happy to be here. I'm
yes,
so
ma'am.
Happy that you had me today.
I thank you so much
for joining us
today, ma'am. Thank you so much, and I wish you luck. I know you'll be successful.
Thank you
and,
so much.
You certainly have the spirit for it. And like I said, the people that's backing you, once you get their blessings, that's it. So this is pretty much it.
Yes, with the team that I have, I already see the win in sight.
Yes, ma'am.
So we just got to get to the finish line, and that's the day that we seal the deal. We're already winning now.
We have your word. You'll be back once you win.
Oh, yes. Please have me back.
Absolutely.
After April 4th, I can't wait to come
yes,
and
ma'am.
Celebrate with everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you so
thank
much,
you,
ma'am.
Thank you.
I want to thank our viewing audience this afternoon. Thank you so much. I want to remind you again, Founders Day will be March the 12th here at CROE, 5:30 to 7:30. That's a Sunday evening. It's our major fundraiser that we have a year. Definitely you want to come on out and support us. It's going to be a who's who as always. It's going to be in person, so please, you know, I don't know where everybody's been, but make sure you wear your mask that evening. But it's going to be a wonderful evening that night. Also, the free film showing will be Saturday, February the 4th at 4 p.m. I'm sorry, February the 4th at 2 p.m. It's going to be free, $3.99. You can't beat that. The film that evening will be Is It Too Late? Thank you so much on behalf of Sugar Al-Amin, CROE organization, CROE media crew. I'm Mandene T. Muhammad. Thank you so much. May Allah continue to bless you with the light of understanding. As I greet you in peace. As-salamu alaykum.